Good evening. I'm Michael Kerner. And before I start, I brought along a secret weapon here. This is a stopwatch, because I'm told I have to be very precise and talk for no more than 7 minutes and no less than 7 minutes. And this stopwatch is actually a very useful one. I used to use this when I raced a starboat at the RCYC. For 7 minutes, as they say in Cambridge, and got an MBA from Harvard. During that period, I courted and married my Peruvian-born wife, who went to Wellesley College. So the three of us are sort of typical Boston-trained people, three very good universities, wonderful universities. And at that point, I needed a job. So I made some applications and got a job in Toronto. We didn't know Toronto and had no friends here, but we settled here. And the job was okay, paid well, but it was boring. So on the side, I started with a couple of friends, I started a small business. And I used to work at it on Saturdays and went out and signed checks and did what people do when they have a few employees. And that started me on the road to being a venture capitalist, an entrepreneur. I even eventually started my own office, and I worked in this field for about 25 years, and I was lucky. Some of my projects actually flourished very well. A couple were stillborn, and I had one disaster, and I think that's sort of the way it goes. But after 25 years, I had done well enough that I formed a foundation. I felt that there was something to give back to society, and I wanted to do that. But I had a very specific definition of how I wanted to be a philanthropist. I applied the same principles that created the capital that I had, and I applied that to philanthropy. Namely, I try to locate great people, great ideas, and take intelligent risks. And I also wanted to stay close to the projects that I was involved in. My approach is very specific. We don't believe in participating in campaigns. All kinds of nice people come and see me and write me letters and want us to be part of a building project or part of an educational project. We don't do that. I apply the same entrepreneurial skills that I developed in my work in philanthropy. So what does that amount to? For instance, let me give you an example. I'm a great believer that one of the wonderful hospitals in Canada is right here in Toronto. It's called CAMH, Centre for Addiction Mental Health. It's one of four great hospitals in the world that focuses on this difficult thing. It's not a fashionable thing to give money to mental health and addiction. It's much easier to support heart research, cancer research, all kinds of things come to mind, but addiction and mental health aren't among them. There was an opportunity to participate at CAMH in a building campaign. I didn't want to do that, but I knew the president and I knew a couple of members of the board, and I asked them a very straightforward question. Who's your best young research scientist, and how can we help him or her? Hence, today there is a brilliant young scientist at CAMH. When we helped him, he had one assistant, in the lab. He now has 18 assistants in the lab. He's been able to get grants from some of the toughest granting agencies in Canada and the United States, which shows that, you know, he's now become self-funding. I find that very exciting. We went to Sunnybrook Hospital, which happens to be very close to where we live, and my wife Sonia was on the board there for about a decade or more, and she was vice chairman. And she eventually retired from that because she was against the policy that the government of Ontario had to merge Sunnybrook with Women's Hospital and the Thritic Hospital. And in fact, she was right, that merger didn't work out well. But we went to Sunnybrook. I went to Sunnybrook because I was interested in research in hearing and vestibular issues. And again, I approached that with a venture capital view. I said, you know, I've sort of designed a budget for a lab, and we're prepared to put up 20% of the budget, and you find 80% of the budget. And in fact, after some struggle, that worked. They decided my budget was too large for the project, so they cut it back. And I'm still doing okay on my lab time. We started a lab, which is called After My Wife, and it's the only hearing lab in Canada. And I go out there every 6 months. I have a son-in-law who's a doctor, so he helps me with areas that I don't understand. And I think we're making traction, and it's exciting to be the only hearing lab in Canada, because all of us at one stage or another in our lives will have a hearing problem, and maybe this lab is going to help in the future. I'm keenly interested in music. I've always played keyboard instruments, and hence I knew about the RCM's expansion plans. First of all, I knew they hired a brilliant architect to be their long-term planner, a woman named Marion McKenna. And those of you who read Maclean's magazine, I'm not recommending Maclean's magazine, but the current lists the 50 most influential people in Canada, and much to my surprise, there's a lovely photograph of Marion, and she's the only architect who made that particular list. In any case, Marion was the design architect for the expansion of the conservatory, and there was an opportunity within her expansion plan to perhaps fund a concert hall, and I took that seriously because I liked her design. I like these veils that float over the hall, and I just felt this had the potential of being a great hall. So being businesslike, my next question was, okay, the architect is wonderful, but you need a good acoustician. So my wife and I went to Lucerne, Switzerland, to meet a man named Bob Essert, who's one of the two or three greatest acousticians working in the world today. He's an American who lives in London and works out of London, works out of a suitcase, actually. He's traveling constantly. And we spent a day with Bob and came to the conclusion he was as good a professional as you could find. So eventually, this hall bears our name, and we're intensely proud of it, because I think it's changed the musical life of Toronto. Music, which used to be downtown, has now moved to Bloor Street. Great musicians play here. We're within our fifth year already on a circuit where great musicians start out at Carnegie Hall or Zenkel Hall or Tully Hall in New York. They come here, they go to London to Wigmore Hall, and then they wind up in Zurich in a hall that I can't pronounce, but it's a circuit. And to be able to establish ourselves in that just shows how great a building this is. Now, Yo-Yo Ma, a cellist that I'm sure all of you have heard of, gave a concert here about a year ago. And it was a fundraiser for the conservatory, and I was sitting next to him at dinner. And Yo-Yo said, you know, I travel around the world, and there's not a better hall of this size that I know of in the world. And that coming from Yo-Yo is quite a statement. When he played here after that dinner, he had people on stage, so there's 1,135 seats in the theater, but I think there were 60 or 70 people on stage with Yo-Yo, and he got a standing ovation because he's just a fantastic player, and he bowed to the audience, and then he made a special bow, which was like this. He bowed to the hall. So we're really thrilled by that. Now, my hypothesis on entrepreneurial philanthropists is simple. Apply the same entrepreneurial principles to giving away capital which you applied to creating it. I feel strongly that foundations should have sunset clauses, namely they should wind up, and perhaps the quicker the better, because the next generation will have a more custodial approach to the foundation's management, and in two or three generations, the custodial approach will be supplanted by a bureaucratic approach. A foundation probably should not last longer than 20 or 25 years. And if you think of the major foundations in the States, take the Ford Foundation. It's been going for an awfully long time. It backs the most incredible number of projects that Henry Ford, if he were alive, would probably be, well, he'd wind it up. Now, the largest foundation today that I think is a model for everybody in philanthropy is the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation. It's the largest entrepreneurial foundation in the world and is run by the remarkable man who created Microsoft. The spirit and entrepreneurial vigor of the Gates Foundation has encouraged Warren Buffett, often Bill Gates' bridge partner, to give the bulk of his fortune to the Gates Foundation. Now, will the Gates Buffett Foundation have a sunset clause? I don't know that. But I'm reasonably sure that Warren Buffett, who does not tolerate bureaucracy, has thought that one through. So to summarize, I've got 30 seconds. So to summarize my hypothesis, entrepreneurial capital that starts to work in philanthropy should apply the same hard-nosed practices which worked in industry. Ideally, the philanthropist entrepreneur, like Bill Gates, should be at the helm. There should be a sunset clause to avoid making the foundation into a bureaucracy. This will work and get the money working creatively. Thank you. 7 minutes.